Now, the Philippines supports a UN resolution condemning Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The resolution is to be put forward at an emergency meeting of the UN General Assembly on the Ukrainian crisis. The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department is calling for the protection of civilians as well as for the cessation of the hostilities there. They also note that the UN Charter requires states to refrain from using force against the political independence of other states. Now, some Filipinos in Ukraine are still refusing to leave despite the dangerous situation there. Zen Hernandez has the details.
Ice cream.
This video was taken just last Wednesday by Filipino nanny Jenny. She was taking her 5-year-old charge for a stroll around Kyiv. But today, the same streets have become a battlefield. Jenny's employer is a member of the Ukrainian parliament, and they have asked her to stay for their child. But Jenny says it's time for her to leave.
Para po matudurog yung puso ko. Kasi dito na ako tumira ng 8 years, immigrant residence na ako dito. Parang second home ko na to. Napakaganda ng Ukraine. Maraming magagandang places dito. I love the people. Kaya nasasaktan ako kasi nakikita ko lahat ng tao naghihirap. Masakit.
Jenny has been corresponding with 3 Filipinas who are taking shelter at the metro. But they had to wait for Kyiv to lift its curfew, which has prevented civilians from leaving their homes for the past 2 days. Now Jenny and the other Filipinos are waiting for the train's evacuation trip that will take them to Lviv at the Polish border, where Philippine government representatives are waiting. So far, 6 Filipinos have been sent home and 13 were evacuated. 6 were also able to cross the Moldovan border, while 28 more Filipinos are expected to evacuate Ukraine within the week.
Ginawa natin, kinuusap na ni Secretary Locsin ang mga foreign ministers ng karatig bansa, kabukaan ng Poland, na nangangailangan kasi talaga sila ng EU visa no, para makapasok. Pero kinuusap na ni Secretary Locsin at pumayag na sila lahat na tanggapin ng ating mga kababayan doon sa kanila mga borders kahit ito ay walang mga visa. No?
Visa.
Dahil ito ay EU countries, pero pumayag na sila at maganda yung development na yon. At with that, yung ating mga kababayan ay ready to enter any of the borders surrounding Ukraine.
But there are Filipinos who have decided not to go back to the Philippines. Jolin was a nanny from Kharkiv near the Russian border. She traveled 32 hours to Ivano-Frankivsk with her employer. But now they have left her with 10 other Filipinos.
Kasi pag humingi kami ng tulong sa embassy, diretso ang uwi namin. Iayaw nga po namin umuwi. Hanap kami ng way na makalabas dito sa ibang border. Tapos magstay lang muna hanggat hindi pa okay yung Ukraine. Tapos pag okay na, babalik na po kami. Hindi po kami uwi. Wala kaming trabaho dyan sa Pinas kung uwi man kami. Basta mahirap po eh. Marami pong pamilyang umaasa sa akin.
Jane was another Filipino who evacuated to Ivano from Kyiv. She is with her baby and Ukrainian husband.
I will stand po with my husband. At this time, kailangan kami magdabayan. Alam kong importante ang safety namin ni baby, pero importante din po yung asawa ko.
Ukrainians aged 18 to 60 years old are not allowed to leave their country due to martial law. Participation in the war is not yet mandatory for all, but some civilians, both men and women, have volunteered to take up arms and fight for their cities. The battle to save the Odessa province near the Black Sea is also raging, affecting passing vessels, including MV Nomura Queen, with 21 Filipino crew on board. All of them are safe, and the ship is now in Turkey.
Okay lang po kami yung sitwasyon namin dito, sir. Okay. Nag-aadda lang po kami ng authority din dito para masundo na rin po kami at para mag-uwi na rin po kami sa pamilya namin, sir.
The Foreign Affairs Department also reported that the 11 Filipinos on board the ship, Yasa Jupiter, are also unharmed. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Ceasefire talks between Ukraine and Russia end with no progress. An advisor to Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says that the meeting ended with representatives heading back to their capitals for further consultations before a second round of negotiations. The talks were held on the border with Russian ally Belarus, which has become a launchpad for the troops invading Ukraine. The Russian invasion has slightly advanced as Ukraine's fierce resistance holds. Russian media says that the troops have seized two small cities in southeastern Ukraine and an area around a nuclear power plant. But Ukraine denies that the Russians have taken over that power plant. Satellite imagery also shows Russian forces moving closer to Ukraine's capital of Kyiv, with the nearest military convoy just 27 kilometers away. As Russian troops advance into Kyiv's city center, Ukrainian President Zelensky advances on the diplomatic front. Zelensky has signed an official request for Ukraine to join the European Union, just hours after he requested for immediate membership into the bloc. Now, over the weekend, the president of the European Commission herself said that the EU wants Ukraine as a member. Meantime, Zelensky urged the West to consider imposing a no-fly zone for Russian missiles, planes and helicopters as Russian airstrikes continue over the city of Kharkiv. The prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, Karim Khan, will look into the alleged war crimes in Ukraine. Khan believes that there is a reasonable basis for war crimes and crimes against humanity in Ukraine. He adds that his investigation rather will include alleged violations dating back to 2014 following Russia's annexation of Crimea. Khan, however, will need authorization from a pre-trial chamber of the ICC before he can proceed with his probe. In a rare move by Switzerland, now they're abandoning their centuries-long neutral stand and now adopting all sanctions imposed by the European Union against Russian individuals and companies. This includes financial sanctions against Russian President Vladimir Putin. Swiss President Ignacio Cassis calls it a difficult but necessary move, as he describes Russia's attack on Ukraine as unacceptable from both a political and a moral point of view. Meanwhile, the U.S. tells 12 Russian diplomats at the United Nations to leave by March 7th amid national security concerns. They're also warning that they will impose more sanctions if Russia continues its war with Ukraine.
I will just ensure my colleagues that the step that the United States government informed the Russian mission of today was taken in full accordance with the headquarters agreement that we signed with the UN, and that those diplomats that have been asked to leave the United States were engaged in activities that were not in accordance with their responsibilities and obligations as diplomats. So under Section 13B of the headquarters agreement, they have been given a request to depart this country so they do not harm the national security of the host country.
The U.S. Authorities have undertaken another hostile action against the Russian mission to the United States, to the United Nations, grossly violating their commitments on the host country agreement that they undertook.
Banks around the world also begin winding down their relationships with Russia as they put Western sanctions against Moscow into practice. In a memo seen by Reuters, British bank HSBC told staffers that they will begin scaling down their sanctions with a host of Russian banks, including VTB, one of those targeted by the Western sanctions. HSBC has little direct exposure in Russia, with around 200 employees and an annual revenue of $15 million. But as the world's leading trade finance bank and Europe's second largest lender, HSBC is a vital cog in the global banking machine, and being cut off from its services is a big blow to Russia. Fund and exchanges are also stepping back from Russia. JP Morgan Asset Management suspended its JP Emerging Europe Equity Fund Monday, and Denmark's Index says they've suspended trading in equity funds with a significant exposure to Russian shares. Meanwhile, the London Stock Exchange has suspended the membership of VTB Capital. Other exchanges are also making similar moves, with the NASDAQ and the Intercontinental Exchange, NYSE, temporarily halting the trading in stocks of companies based in Russia. Two leading banks in South Korea also confirm that while they have not yet received specific guidelines from SWIFT, that they've stopped trade financing with at least seven Russian banks.
We have already seen Russia take enormously defensive measures as a result. So they have Russia today has announced a series of capital control measures and potentially has even announced a pending default on its foreign bond obligations, which is a big deal. So if it is, if the question is, have they been effective? They are certainly effective in weakening Russia's economy, weakening its financial fortress defensive measures. Whether they will serve to alter President Putin's strategy towards Ukraine remains another question. But clearly, these are very significant sanctions that will cut Russia off from the global financial system for as far as the eye can see.
Or companies exit Russia as sanctions continue to pour in. Energy giant Shell will stop all of their Russian operations, including a major liquefied natural gas plant, which is 50% owned and operated by Russian gas group Gazprom. Shell admits their exit from Russia will lead to impairments, but they say they cannot stand by what they describe as Moscow's senseless act of military aggression. Dublin-based AerCap, the world's biggest aircraft leasing company, says that they will terminate hundreds of aircraft leases with Russian airlines. AerCap's shares dropped over 12% following the news as 5% of its fleet is leased in Russia. Global automakers and truck makers, including General Motors and Germany's Daimler Truck, also suspended some business in Russia. Volkswagen suspended deliveries of cars to dealers in Russia, and Swedish automaker Volvo and GM said that they will stop exports to Russia as well. Meanwhile, Microsoft says that they will remove Russian state-owned media outlets, RT's mobile apps, from its Windows App Store and ban ads on Russian state-sponsored media. Now, Walt Disney saying that they are pausing the release of theatrical films in Russia, including Pixar's animated film Turning Red. They are the first major Hollywood studio to do so. Disney says they're also working with NGOs to help with humanitarian aid.